Cooper Webb, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Dean Wilson.
I'm Aaron Plessinger.
I'm Jerry Martin.
I'm Nate Thrasher.
I'm Shane McElrath.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
My name's Jet Lawrence.
I'm Jordan Smith.
I'm Talon Hawkins.
Stargate Hampshire.
I'm Hayden Deegan.
I'm Colt Nichols.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Tom Diala. I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Jiren Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
Hey everyone, welcome to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Today I'm joined by a guy that I don't need to introduce, Brian Deegan. Dude, I'm so stoked to have you on, one, but I was like driving in today, and as I told you, I was thinking about like how long we've known each other, how much we've worked together through the years and everything, and it's just like surreal now that you're here and you're in this place in your life right now. That you are, you know, like I met you when you were a privateer out here. I think it was even before the Team Chaparral deal. You had like Kool-Aid in your hair. Do you remember that?
Yeah, that was '95. That was when I was Princeton Honda with Chad Pedersen, privateer Honda team. Actually, and that was '95 when I got second at the GFI Supercross Invitational, the big race before Supercross. At Paris, and I remember, I dyed my hair purple, I think.
I was like, how'd you do that? And you're all Kool-Aid. How does that work?
Yeah, I remember I bleached my, went through the bleach phase. Mm-hmm. You know, I went to California, had to have bleach hair. That was when Tony Hawk had the cool flop, you know, like, I was like, oh, I want to do that. And so, you know, kid from Nebraska, I was just like, bleached the hair, and then it got into, we started coloring our hair and stuff back before it was a thing.
So when you came to California, the dream was race Supercross. Make it there. What do you think the pinnacle of your racing was? Obviously the LA Supercross win, but if you took a season like with a team, because there was plenty of teams.
Yeah, I mean, to go back to that, it's, man, there's so much to reminisce on there, but really my goal as a kid, I remember, and I still have this in my head, like every night when I go to bed, I would pray that I would become a factory rider. I'd be like, I just want to be a factory rider, make it to California, race Supercross, and I would tell myself that every day. And so my goal was to go to race Supercross and be on a factory team and try to win races, and it was a big lofty goal for a kid, you know, out of Nebraska, coming from a family that knew no racing.
Yeah.
And my dad was a teacher in the school system. He didn't know how to ride a dirt bike, and so it's just a kind of a crazy story. And I actually reached out for the first time in probably a decade to the guy who got me into racing dirt bikes. He was my neighbor. He still lives there in that small town in Nebraska. My dad got him a job at the school district, and he's still there working for the school, the landscaper for the school district. But he was a 17, 18-year-old dude who moved in, looked like Eddie Van Halen, jean jacket, like he was just a cool dude, rode race dirt bikes from Europe. And I just fell in love with it. I was like, this guy's so cool, and his bike's cool. I just like would sit there and watch and him every day when I got home from school. And then I asked my dad if I could get a dirt bike. He's like, nah, no. And I said, well, if I earn it, can I? He's like, if you go earn the money, then you can have a dirt bike. So I got a paper out and started saving money and selling things and ended up getting enough money to buy my first dirt bike. And then eventually my dad saw, and my neighbor would take me to the track with him. Well, so imagine that. We got a 17-year-old dude who looks like a rocker in his old junky truck that we had to put water in the radiator every hour to so it didn't overheat. And to make it to the track, and I had change and dollar bills that I used to get into to ride during the week at Fort Calhoun, Nebraska. I still remember.
What year was that?
That was in probably 84, 85.
85. So you bought your first bike with paper route money. Was it a used bike? Or?
Oh, yeah. My first bike so was a used YZ.
Like $2,000 around there?
Yeah, if that. Like it was a used. My first bike was a MR50. Honda, me and my brother had to share.
Yeah.
And then my dad helped us buy our first bikes, was an 82 YZ60. Mm-hmm. And that was in 85. So yeah, I had all kind of, you know, that was my first bike. And then once my dad saw it, like, really just was so, you know, infatuated with it, he, for Christmas, got me a KX60, a new KX60. Yeah. That was a big
deal. Dude, your first new bike.
Yeah, and I couldn't wait. And I took it out in the snow and I rode it around. And we had a little circle track in our backyard that we shoveled and rode it in the snow. And I just remember riding around just so amped, you know, and I'll never forget that. That's, you know, definitely how it started.
So the, you know, the ups and downs of all the amateur racing and stuff. Did you hit all the big stuff as amateur before you came out to California?
I
think you showed me a Loretta Lynn's finisher.
Something participation. Yeah. So my neighbor, like I said, got me into local racing. That's when I met like guys like Denny Stevenson, you know, that told me, hey, you need to go to Ponca City. That was my first national I went to was Ponca. Mm-hmm. I remember lining up. I have these pictures still. My dad would take a lot of pictures, and I was always like, Dad, what are you taking pictures? And then I'm so happy he did that. You know, I look back, and I was like, why didn't we take more, you know? And so there's a picture of me on the starting line on, you know, my huge chest plate, barely didn't even fit in my helmet. It was big, and I had these boots that were two sizes too big, and all used gear, and I was on the starting line with the full gate at Ponca, and Ezra Lusk was next to me on the DMC 60. That was like an 85. The thing was super trick, tall, aluminum swing arm, just the baddest bike. And he was next to me. I was just like, and I'll never forget that picture. You know? And anyway, so that was 86. And I got, I think I got like 16th or something. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where it started. And then they told me, you got to go to Loretta's from Ponca. And we didn't know what to do. So by the next year, I figured that out.
Yeah.
And I eventually went to Loretta's, I think, 2 or 3 years later.
So come to California as a 125 Pro.
Yeah.
Like I said, I asked you earlier, but you didn't really answer. Like, what was the pinnacle of motocross for you? Like, you wanted to be on a factory team, but was like, Moto Triple X, the closest you got to factory, you think?
I would say, yeah. Closest I got to a factory deal was Washougal. I was Team Green. Team Green gave me a couple bikes a year. And I just remember they told me I wanted to turn pro, and they wanted me to keep racing amateur. And so I started racing pro on my own, like out of our van, you know, on a team, took a couple Team Green bikes. And we raced. I was number 279 my first pro year. And then I got number 58, and I was still Team Green. The only way they were going to help me with bikes, though, is I had to come back and race some amateur races, which I was like, I don't want to race amateur. I have a national number.
Yeah.
You know, it was me. I remember they made me and Scott Sheik race Loretta's, and he was 55. I was 58. Mm-hmm. And I think Wyndham beat us both maybe that year. Anyhow, Mitch Payton let me ride Pedro Gonzalez's bike at Washougal that year, and I think it was 93, 94. Mm-hmm. And he said, and Pedro got hurt, couldn't ride the race, and so they gave me the bike race day, and we're like, hey, you can race this bike, but I already done the practice on Friday on my bike, so they put me on this bike. It's tall, the seat's tall, bars are tall. I'm like, this bike feels so weird.
Yeah.
And then it's like, all right, go. And I go out to your morning qualifiers and all that, and I was trying to figure the bike out. He said, if you get top 10 on this bike, because I'd always go to Mitch, and, hey, man, I'm Brian. I wanted to ride so bad. Like, I just wanted to, like, get on those tracks and ride a supercross track, because back then you didn't get to ride supercross. Yeah. You got to, you know, like, the local track was your prep for supercross.
Yeah.
And so he said, top 10, if you get top 10, we'll keep helping you. Mm-hmm. And I just remember that day, and I'm trying to remember exactly what it was, but I think I went like a 10, 12 for like 11th or something. And that was it. I didn't do it. You know, it was something around 11th or 12th. And I was just like, no way. And that was kind of my closest shot of getting a factory deal. And I remember just keep asking Mitch, and I just wasn't on the inside, man. Yeah. And I get it, because now I am on the inside. But I wasn't then. I didn't grow up here. And there is something to that. There's something to being in the scene, being in the SoCal crowd, being around the factories. And when opportunities arise, you get a shot, you know? And I just wasn't on the inside crowd then, you know? I was trying to meet people and but I just wasn't, you know.
That's funny. You hear so many stories about guys going to Mitch's office and rolling into his office and asking for a ride, and he ignores you and acts like he doesn't know who you are.
Yeah, yeah. He did that to me many times. Many times I walked in and he'd be grinding a cylinder, and and I would stand there for like 20, 30 minutes and just wait.
Yeah, he knows you're there.
He knows he saw me, and I'm like, this dude made me so mad, and I'd just be like, but it's part of the game. You got to be patient, and I mean, it never paid off for me, and then the closest I got was, you know, I ended up realizing, I went to Princeton Honda, left Team Green, Honda deal with Chad Patterson. That was the best I ever did outdoors, because it was a pro circuit, 95 pro circuit Honda 125, probably the best bike you could have for that year. Good starts. I trained my ass off. Like I couldn't train any harder. That was one thing I could do without, you know, having to pay for it. So I was always the guy that would pass guys toward the end of the race. I just didn't fade. So I had a top 10 in those outdoors, and I was just trying to get a ride. I remember shopping, asking. Mitch was interested, but I just wasn't a supercross guy because I'd never ridden it. But I was like, dude, trust me, I will I'll put in so much work. I'll, you know, do whatever it takes. And just, I wasn't good enough, I guess, in the day, right? So, and I remember him talking about it. And I remember the mechanics going out there. He is talking about getting you on the team. And I was just like, oh, I just thought like, okay, this is it. And it just didn't happen. And so I lived that. Like I lived those moments of almost. And then I kind of realized at that point, I ain't getting a factory ride. I was talking to the guys. That's when we started filming Krusty's and Moto Triple X. And then I kind of came up with the idea with the guys from Moto Triple X of like, let's just start our own deal. And I just knew it was the end of my career kind of there. I knew like it wasn't going to be the right move. But I was kind of like, F it, dude. Like I tried. And I know this was a career killer, but I was like, we're just having some fun. And the video thing was taking off. So don't think I didn't have a plan. Like I wasn't just like, I'm going to burn my career. And I knew freestyle was going. I knew that was taking off. I started getting paid by companies to represent them for just free riding. So I went out, trained my ass off, still train. And I remember going to Larry's house because he had a supercross track we built with a little tractor, and doing 20 lap main events 3 or 4 days a week before supercross. I was just like, I want to do good. So I went out, and LA Coliseum was 97 when I first race came out. Jumped the triple, Partridge didn't jump, it doubled it, and I landed on his head. And ended up going to my butt on the triple, boom, ended up breaking my back. Fracturing my T9 vertebrae, squishing it. And so I was like, and I just remember like I couldn't race, so bummed, you know, all that. And I couldn't race, and we went home, and all week I was just sitting there, I couldn't take a deep breath. And the weekend came, I'm like, I was talking to the team as a doubleheader. I'm like, dude, we got to try. So I go out, and Asterix wasn't around then. They probably would have shut this down real quick. But I go out, ride practice. I'm like, every time I land, I was like really hurt, like hard to breathe. I was like, dude, I'm trying. So I go qualify for the main. In the main, I remember starting on the inside or something. The clutch was messed up. Bike's lunging. Take off, don't get the best jump, come around the inside, everyone just runs into each other. I mean, it was a lot of dudes. I think it was like Carmichael, Windham, Ramsey, all the heavy hitters in there. Boom, come around the inside. And I'm learning second or third. I'm like so amped because I'm like in the top three, you know? And I just remember catching Renard. He starts fading. I'm like, no way, dude. I'm going to freaking lead the race. Pass him. And I just remember the crowd, hit him over the triple or pass him. And I just remember the crowd like going crazy. I just still remember it to this day. And I'm leading the race. I'm just like, don't crash. And I'm just trying to stay up. And Wyndham was coming. I could hear the crowd. And came around that last lap, and it was these ruddy whoops. I'm just like, don't crash, like trying to get through the whoops. And I was like, no way, I'm fucking win this race, dude. And I just come to the finish, and I'm like, and just ghost rode the bike. And it was all like a last minute decision. And I launched the bike, and I boom, hit the ground. Bike lands perfect. It almost takes out Kenny. Who's running up the landing? Like, when would you ever, like, you would never see that today, right?
Yeah, no way.
A mechanic running up the landing during a race. And it just missed some storybook, like, falls over perfect. Kenny runs it. And we're celebrating, like, second, third, fourth. They're still battling. Like, there's still a race going on. Yeah. And we didn't care. And Fortunately, the bike didn't land on the landing. It could have been really bad.
Yeah.
So anyhow, it was, you know, storybook night. And I feel like that moment checked off like something in my mind, in my life of going, I accomplished that goal that I've always wanted. Like I prayed about that, you know, and I accomplished it. And from that point on, the career went where it went, you know, and I felt like I should have got a factory ride. I think they had a factory bike still available at Suzuki. Mm-hmm. Someone got hurt. I was like, hey, can I get on that bike? And Moto Triple X was cool with it if I left and factory ride. And they ended up giving the bike, I think, to Ryan Huffman, I think, or something back then. And I just remember, I was like, dude, it ain't happening, you know? And I was like, and that was kind of where I just really went down the freestyle path and started focusing on that. But it was the hardest thing for me was walking away from racing and the time me and my dad spent together racing. Like he put a lot in, he put everything into it he could, right? He didn't modest salary, didn't really have much money to spend on racing, but whatever he had, he helped me. And, you know, I would say we were moto poor. Yeah. I don't think you can ever be really poor, right, racing dirt bikes, right?
Yeah,
but
yeah.
We were pretty moto poor, which means we kind of had one or two bikes a year and had to sell them to buy new ones.
Uh-huh.
So anyway, my point is, we invested a lot, and it was hard for me to walk away because my dad. I just felt like I was letting him down. And but I had the alternative of freestyle, and that's kind of where it all went that way. And then when I went all in on that, it started blowing up.
Yeah.
So that was just another chapter. But yeah, so your question, the answer was, I think the pinnacle of my career in racing was that winning that Supercross, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for a lot more. Welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Again, dude, I didn't know that you had a broken back when you won that race.
Yeah.
So that was such an iconic photo, too.
Yeah.
I remember I was there.
Two pictures came from that.
There, but I was like, what just happened? Like, I didn't realize you had ghost written. I was like, did he drag his foot and fall or what? But
It was... To this day, out of everywhere I go, like when our travels and I run into people, mostly middle-aged men, the one thing I hear the most, hands down, of everything I've done in my life is, I was there that night.
Yeah.
And that's all they say. I'm like, I was there that night. And I know exactly what they're saying. It's pretty gnarly to think, like, one moment in racing that got remembered, you know?
That'll never be forgotten.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's cool because it was my only Supercross win. And, it was just like, the stamp on it, you know, it's to me, I get excited talking about it because it was just I've worked hard for that and it all played out perfect. And I did hurt my back the week before and my bike was seizing. I remember like the last lap, the bike was funky and I'm like, no way, dude, this bike's like running weird. And it ended up like hanging a ring.
Oh.
And it scarred the cylinder.
Yeah.
And that bike was a turd anyway. It was like so slow, you know,
those
and,
forks. Dude, yeah. Remember how Jordan brought that bike to the Coliseum?
Mm-hmm.
Chase, our video guy, he saw it and he goes, what's wrong with that number plate? Remember the weird upside down or the conventional fork and the number plate?
That was a funky bike.
Yeah.
We're actually finally doing a rebuild of that bike. I found a dude who built that number, the 38 smoke, the two smoke or whatever it was, danger smoke video. Mm-hmm. The old bike I rode, that old Yamaha, he built that one, and we got to know each other pretty well. And he's like, I'll help you rebuild that wind bike if you can find one. I said, all right, I actually know where one is. Just sitting there, I can get. So he's rebuilding one that's going to be a replica. So that's cool.
Yeah.
Something I can actually ride and burnouts on and keep the memory alive, I guess. I'm like the old football guy from high school. I just keep telling the same story. You know?
Yeah.
Al Bundy.
Hey, is that year the same year you had the glitter bike at Washougal?
Yeah, glitter bike at Washougal.
The glitter bike. Like, what was that about? Just like, we got to do something funny.
I think it was a, everything we did was a FU to like, was to like the corporate ways of moto, you know, which is so funny how things go full circle. But yeah, I feel like that was like, we showed up, Kenny glittered the whole bike.
Was it literally just like
real Elmer's glue on the bike and glittered it? Yeah. And it, I mean, it was a lot of work, but they did it, and they did my boots and my helmet. I still have the helmet. I kept a lot of my old helmets, but that one's sitting somewhere on the shelf. And so I remember rolling up, and like the whole industry's just like, dude, this guy, like, but we were having fun. Yeah. The fans loved it. They all got it. And they still talk about it.
Yeah.
You know, the fans from Washougal, which are awesome fans up there. They're gnarly. And so I remember first moto, I came out and I was going fast, pretty good, like top 10, and boom, got taken out on the start. And I remember crashing, ripped my radiator off. And I'm like, no way.
Oh.
And then second moto, I came out. And I remember battling with, I think it, like, this is me trying to remember many years ago, Pashon and Roncada, maybe, like battling with them the whole race.
Yeah.
And like, you're back and forth on the glitter bike, dude. It was so funny. You don't see that anymore. You know, that
I was there
anymore.
Too. I was at that race too, so I got to see that. I remember I walked up, I was like, dude, what is this?
Yeah.
It was all rough.
It was a little much for sure. It was full, like, I was full crusty, like a freestyle guy.
Yeah. So after that season with Moto Triple X, did you continue to race, or was it just the freestyle switch?
That was like right when it was kicking off. Freestyle was getting big. And then the end of the year, I remember they wanted to switch bikes. So we went to Cali, back to Moto Triple X again, 98. I think Metzger was on with me, which bad combo, me and Metzger together on a race team.
Is that the year that you made the training video with the whips and the leather?
Oh, jeez. I was hoping that thing would disappear, dude. That's so bad. But that was me, young kid in California, moving in with my buddy. We just thought it was funny, man. We just thought we would do funny stuff, and we just made each other laugh. And and that was a little much. That one was a little gnarly. But it actually, dude, it's just funny. Like, I look at it, it's harmless. Like, I, you know, the end of the day, we did those skits, and we were just doing it to make the guys from Krusty and Motor Shows laugh.
Yeah.
They were like, check this out. And they were like, oh, we'd send these videos. It was no phones. It was more just film it and a little camera. And, but yeah, that was around the same time. And I lived with Metzger. Yeah, I was his roommate. He actually let me live with them and rent a room. And yeah, we had some funny memories, man. He was a funny dude. And it's just great chapters of life.
Yeah.
They filmed the that Fox movie, I forget the name of it, the one they with Loke Dog Don't Ride for No Trick Ass Bitches.
Yeah.
What
Fresno,
was that?
Fresno
Smooth. Yeah. So they filmed that some at his house. And you gotta think of that era was so fun, dude, in the 90s. Like it just was such a fun era. And so anyhow, my back to the bike. 98 was Cowie's. We went to Cowie. I remember Pro Circuit was helping us, and all production off the shelf stuff. Those bikes were so slow, dude. like so bad. And I remember racing. We were just getting smoked. And I remember it was kind of the final straw was Mount Morris. My Kenny, from what I understand, he forgot to put radiator fluid in the bike. And I made it a few laps, seized right on the main, by the finish line up top. In the crowds, and I remember getting off, I was so mad, and I just threw my helmet, wow. And I threw it into the crowd, like way in the air, wow. Threw it, and some dude, Stoke, gets the helmet. And I think I walked up and drank a beer or something with like the fans or something. And they, Moto Triple X tried to get me to write an apology letter to the AMA. Because they were mad because I threw the helmet, which I get it, could have hit someone, that was their point.
Yeah.
And I mean, you've seen, I looked down the road, Dungy did, a lot of people did that, okay? I wasn't the only one that threw the helmet, but Anyhow, my point is, write an apology letter. I said, okay, let me get this straight. We're the anti-corporate, anti-everything, and you want me to write an apology letter to the AMA? And I'm like, F you, dude. I ain't doing that. Yeah. And then it just, that was like, bam. Like, it was like a line in, you know, the sand. And I said, all right, dude, later. And they said, later. Mm-hmm. And that was kind of the breakup right there. Then I ended up, I didn't want to go down this story, waste too much time on it. But I ended up at Stiffy, remember?
Yeah.
That for like a few rounds and the credit card didn't work.
Over the boot pants.
Yeah, I almost won LA Supercross in over the boot pants. Yeah, I realized I got an O'Neill deal right before the race, seconds before that race. I was wearing SMP baggies, dude, because the freestyle was kicking off. Yeah, I know we can laugh, oh, it's so lame, but freestyle was blowing up at that point, dude. And freestyle was a lot of momentum. And and so I was like, baggy pants, all that. And I almost wore that at that race, LA Coliseum.
Yeah.
I'm glad I won it in gear, to be honest. It would have been kind of funny. Yeah. But like, I look back at that and the whole baggy pants scene and all that. And then that fit in freestyle. That's where it belonged. And so anyway, 98 happened. That's when I kind of walked away from the sport. I was at that point, Team Stiffy. I kind of realized this is, you know, we're hanging on by a straw. Credit cards weren't working, and I was like, dude, I'm out. Boom. And that's when I went full focus on freestyle motocross, and went all in. That was 99. When Mickey Diamond helped design the course at Larry's, built it at Larry's, had meetings with ESPN, and figured out how to do a judging format. And there was only like 10 guys at the time really doing freestyle. You know, it was, I think it was Metzger, Pastrana, Sink Myers, Mad Mike. The list was, you know, the OGs. And so we created that event at X Games in 99 under the bridge there at San Francisco. And once we cracked the bikes, started hitting the jumps, 80-foot, 100-foot doubles, everyone just came running. It was like, boom, it just like launched, you know. So right then I knew, I was like, this is going to be big. So crazy. It was like, it happened, everything kind of like played out for a reason, you know.
One more break to hear from our sponsors. We're back for more. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Okay, so the first freestyle contest happened in Havasu. Was that when you were still racing, though, right?
That was right at the end of my career, 90. I think it was around 98.
Yeah.
The real freestyle kicked off. The very first freestyle demo we put on at Winchester Arena in 97. We built jumps at the arena. Had heavy metal bands play, and then a lot of people showed up. I remember there was thousands, and it was packed, and just chaos. I hit dirt bikes and music, and that was 97. I still have tickets to it, and somewhere in my book. But that was 97, and then 98 was when, was it Four Leaf or something? I forget the name of the association that tried to have the freestyle demo or events.
Yeah.
And that was, I think it was Havasu was probably the first one where they built the big course and judging. Mm-hmm. And That was, yeah, that's cool. I remember I was riding a 125 like race bike. Like, yeah, my 98. Yeah.
That's crazy. That's funny to think I was there too.
Yeah, in all these moments. Yeah. But another, that's like T-shirt, man. I was there. Yeah.
Another moment that stands out is I remember you invited me to Link's house. Mm-hmm. You're like, hey, come shoot.
Yeah.
And you and Larry were riding.
Mm-hmm.
And you had a, what do they call it, the scissor lift?
Yeah.
And you're like, hey, you can go up in there, it'd be sick, better mm-hmm. angles. And I went up in it. And I remember Marissa was there.
Really?
And she went up in it with me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, this would be a better angle if we were like 5 feet that way.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't think about it, I didn't know. But yeah. we were like almost fully extended, and I turned it on and moved it and went,
no, oh, geez.
And I was like, I was like, sorry. Like almost killed us both. But when did the militia stuff start happening? Because was it that day? I remember seeing you guys writing all over your bikes and everything. And
yeah, it was, I think, kind of from the beginning of freestyle, you know, from where it, before it was even really a sport, right?
Yeah.
It was just kind of like that whole vibe of that area right there and Madeira de Playa, that street where it all kind of started, you know? And that's where it all kind of like originated, is that area, and freestyle really mm-hmm. kicked it off. But yeah, it was really, I would say from the beginning was there. And then we were thinking, man, how do we, it was kind of just the name of the freestyle group. I think at the time with Larry, and Larry had a couple of his buddies, and then Feist and Twitch came on, and I remember meeting Twitch at one of the first events, and I just remember he was twitching, like saying, like cussing, and we're like, dude, this dude's pretty sweet over here, yeah. you know, and he was just so degaff, and
yeah.
we just thought he was super cool.
Do you remember him? Yeah. He was at the first freestyle.
Yeah, yeah.
He wasn't good enough to ride yet, but I remember him hanging out and being there. And
yeah, yeah, he was definitely one of the starters of it all, and so that, and then it, I'd say Militia was kind of just like the group name, and then I thought, man, let's. We should, once we took the X Games and all this, mm-hmm. we got to really do this right and do a company and try to build this thing. And
yeah, but I just remember you had Sharpies.
Yeah, it started with spray paint.
Sharpies,
or, yeah, stenciling on everything and just Sharpie markered everything. Yeah.
Do you remember I was like, hey, Brian, why did you spell it that way? And you're like, oh, Larry ain't the smartest guy.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that was Larry's deal, and I don't know if he meant to do it wrong or did it wrong. I can't even verify that, but yeah. it actually was pretty genius at this point because it was it's so unique the way it's spelled that it got us through a lot of loopholes, because Militia is a pretty common name, right?
Yeah.
So very hard to trademark and protect, but once you put the U in it, it's completely unique, right?
Yeah.
So it that tells it all, right? Yeah. That you know, that way it's spelled. So yeah, I think it was pretty unique. But look now everything's taken. Everything's trademarked, right?
Yeah.
So now if you want to build a brand, you have to spell it wrong.
Yeah.
To even think you're going to trademark it, or even think, and it's normal now, right?
Yeah.
It's normal to have stuff spelled wrong.
Yeah.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Like who's to say like that, the way the words are spelled, like that's the end all be all, right? No, it's changing. Everything's changing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, soon the words will mean different things and spelt different ways, and that's just the way companies are going now.
Yeah. The Metal Mulisha thing, you know, you guys made it a company, mm-hmm. a brand. It blew up.
Mm-hmm.
For you in freestyle competition, what is your pinnacle of that? Would it be the...
Yeah.
Like, it's funny, because, okay, so this weekend coming up, right, is 20-year anniversary mm-hmm. of LA X Games.
Okay.
When you did the 360.
Oh, yeah.
And it's funny because I was there.
Mm-hmm.
I remember I knew it was coming because you told me what you were going to do, and you pull it off.
Yeah.
And then Travis comes next, mm-hmm. does it and crashes. The timer runs out.
Yeah.
And then he's all one more and does it and he wins. I remember thinking like, man, how did that happen?
But it's all theater, dude. Yeah. At the end of the day, right? X Games is a show. It's an entertainment.
Yeah.
Way more than racing is, right? Mm-hmm. They can maneuver. Anything that's judged can be maneuvered around, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's a show. And I realized that, you know, as time went on, I was mad for sure that night, you know, because I was like, man, I went out there, took the risk, landed it, and Travis tried and crashed and you know, oh, let me go timeout, let me go again. I get it. He was the star of the show, and he, you know, they sold a lot more probably sponsors on him for sure. Mm-hmm. So it's fine, you know, but I think that was a typical battle between two dudes trying to one-up each other. Whether that gold piece of metal or not, you know, that night didn't matter. That was about two dudes, the OG way of one-upping each other on a dirt bike in free riding. Who's going to do the trick, the gnarliest trick, and land it first.
Yeah. That was, but remember just how like secret it was. Like, everybody, is it kind of weird that you both thought of the same thing?
And I, you know, the bottom line is he was doing it in a foam pit, and then I saw it on a video. You know, I saw it on a video, and I was like, dude, he's doing like a crazy backflip, like this 360 thing. And I was like, checking out. He did a lot of crazy stuff in a foam pit that I think most of it didn't ever went to dirt.
Yeah.
So I'd always kind of watch what he did, and because he's so creative. And I was like, I think we can do that. And so I had a foam pit at the time. Remember, when we started freestyling, no foam pits. I learned to backflip on dirt. It was gnarly. Like, I still, like, to this day, have torn ACL from it and broken ribs, scarred up from that. And that was one of the hardest things for me to overcome, the back, when the backflip came in, which is a whole different story. But that was one of the scariest moments of my life, going, I got to hang on, commit. Most guys quit. Most guys were out of the sport at that point, and forced out because they wouldn't flip. So, and I just remember committing and doing the backflip over and over and crashing and trying to learn it on dirt. So that was a gnarly pinnacle of the sport. But my point is that night with the 360 with Travis, I feel like that was, I was able to land it first. We still laugh about it to this day.
Yeah.
We still I'm racing them this weekend at Nitrocross, and we still are battling and like making bets of like who's gonna beat who, and it's fun. You know, it's cool. I'm glad we've had a cool relationship. It didn't start off good. It started off like I couldn't stand the dude. Like, you know, we were anti, we were militia, and he was a good guy. And then that story played out great, you know. Yeah. And now things are obviously different. We're both dads and, you know, have kids and families, and we're still racing each other.
Dude, it's awesome though, the way you guys started out that way, and now you're still battling each other, and now you're friends, and you have a lot of respect for each other.
A lot of respect for him. Dude, there's no one gnarlier than that, dude.
Yeah.
There isn't. I don't care what anyone says. I'm sure there is in other categories of life, but in our world, he's the gnarliest.
Yeah.
Think about a dude at the pinnacle of the sport of racing, factory rider, has everything going for him, young, won all the amateur championships, the next big thing, next phenom, wins outdoor championship, Supercross, I think. And he's like, hey, I'm jumping dirt bikes at X Games. It's more fun later. Walks away from the sport. And that's gnarly.
Like, that's balls.
Imagine that. That'd be like Hayden, for example, like just going, hey, dude, I want to go to a freestyle motocross piece out. People would be like, what? Yeah. You know, like, dude, I high five him because he took a path. I mean, I don't think that would work today because it's already been done with freestyle. Freestyle's already run its course.
Yeah.
But Travis saw the beginning of something massive, the movement of action sports. And he jumped on the front of it instead of staying in racing at the time. And I think he made tenfold doing it, you know?
Absolutely.
And probably had more fun, you know? I don't know. It's hard to say because I think racing's fun. You know, like I enjoy racing. I love racing dirt bikes. I love dirt bikes. So. To me, I see that as fun. But for him, he saw a path and took it, and everyone was like, you know, the motor industry, how they do it. And he's just like, later, and freaking pulled it, right? And he still comes back, helps the sport, still a big part of it. Like, I just think that dude has done it right, man. Mm-hmm. Like, I give him credit for sure.
All right, Brian, we're out of time, but we've known each other for way too long to cut this at one show. So we're going to come back next week for part two. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next week.